So my name is Matteo. Today I'm going to speak about components from microservices and front-end. So today my talk is going to be a long talk. Hopefully it's going to be a little bit interactive. So I'm going to try to ask things to you, and we're going to see how it goes. The main goal of this talk for you, I think, is to be inspired by our case study. So today I'm mainly going to speak about our experience about the company I work for. We decided to go to continuous delivery and to apply a lot of practices a couple of years ago. And today I'm going to tell you a little bit about the story, what happened, what I think we did right, what I think we did maybe less right or wrong. And I think I will be happy if after this talk you will be inspired to see if we can do something like that in your company, or if you think about this approach to be interesting. So let me introduce myself. I am a software engineer, so I've been writing code since I was 15, so more than a half life ago, many years ago. And I like technology. Sometimes I speak in conferences. I mainly speak about what I do because I, it's okay. Yes, sorry, I've been covering the slides by myself. And I usually speak about what I do. I am a big fanatic of open source, so usually when I try to do something that I love, I try to open source it by default. I think that's the best thing about our job, because we can share what we do and with openness. And I'm based in London, but I'm Italian. And I work for a company called OpenTable. So just to introduce a little bit the context. So OpenTable is an American company, and we mainly provide software for restaurants. So the core of the business is that we have a system that allows people to make free, instantly confirmed reservations on the website, on restaurants that are our clients. These restaurants are more than 30,000 restaurants worldwide. And every month we have something around 16 million reservations, and we have almost 500,000 reviews per month. I think this is useful to understand a little bit the scale of the problem. Also, we are our business operates in Europe, America, Asia, and we have software engineers in, located in mainly in San Francisco, London, and Mumbai, India. So we need to make these engineers work well together, and this is not very easy. Every time we make a commit, every time we actually make a change to our code, we know that as soon as this code is going to be in production, we are going to have millions of requests per minute to be handled. So our code needs to be stable and needs to actually scale. The talk today is going to be about our front end, and specifically for our front end, we have something around 50 engineers that every day make changes to the code. We have, I think, something around 200 engineers working on many projects. Today, I'm going to focus about the front end. What I mean for front end is the consumer website that we have. So, when I mentioned how our business works, I should mention that the restaurants that are our clients actually run our software on their restaurants. This interacts with our data centers, which are mainly located in Europe and US. Then we have a consumer website, which is actually where all the users can for free subscribe and make reservations. We have mobile apps. We have software written in basically any language, probably, and legacy code, and have something around 15 years of experience on this field. So as you can imagine, there is a lot of legacy code, a lot of new code, software written in many languages, and 15 years of engineers coming and going and writing pieces of this code. So I would say something that realistically is not beautiful. It's normal, it's real life. Sometimes it's great, sometimes it's not, and we need to deal with it. So the agenda for this talk, so I'm going to speak about the microservice architecture, which is something we implemented. We call it like that. I don't know if anyone else in the world call it microservices. But if you want, it's something around, something similar to the concept of microservice, but applied to the web. I'm going to speak about the second step, which is actually the second level of componentization. I'm going to mention a framework that we build and we open source, which is Open Components, but I'm also going to speak about the architecture level, so something a little bit useful, hopefully, for both an engineering point of view, but also a cultural point of view. Then I'm going to speak a little bit more about the agile implication of these choices. So just to understand a little bit, how many of you are software engineers? Okay, quite a big number. How many of you are people that work in product, product owners? Okay. And so basically, for me, when I submitted the talk to Agile India, I thought, well, that actually makes sense, because for me, I'm a big fan of Agile. The problem, I think, in our job when we write software is sometimes Agile is just a buzzword. It's actually, yes, do you do Agile? Yes. When you do an interview, you ask someone, what about Agile? And say, yeah, we do this stuff. I know about this and this. But the reality is, Agile is not really just setting up some meetings on your calendar. It's actually making engineers and product work very well together. And if you don't do that, you are not doing Agile. Sometimes, as engineers, we actually are very used to actually make compromises. We want to deliver something. We know about technical debt. We want to find the best way to deliver the job. And sometimes, it's quite easy and tempting to say, we are just gonna try to avoid speaking with the others. So the engineers are gonna try to agree with product, and then we are gonna try to do our stuff, and then maybe they are gonna come back. But it's gonna be something like a complicated relationship, I would say. For me, it's important to have this relationship, keep it alive, and deal every day. So let's start. Let's get started. So the story starts a couple of years ago. I've been in this company for 3 years. Today, I'm going to speak a little bit about this story. I'm going to tell you a couple of secrets, and I'm going to try to put you through the path we follow. So just to give you a quick introduction, so in 2012 I joined in 2013, but I think the dates are quite right, given what my colleagues told me. So in 2012, we actually set up for the first time a homogeneous continuous integration pipeline. Before, we used to do something different. Each project used to do what they wanted. In 2012, we set up an integrated continuous delivery, a continuous integration pipeline. All the projects had to be integrated there, and that was 2012. 2013, we decided that GitHub was a very good way to actually be productive as engineers. We moved all the source control to Git. We used to use a little bit of Git already, but in combination of Subversion and other systems, we decided that Git and the pull request method was something that was something that could deliver some value to us, and we decided to go to there. So since 2013, we decided to move everything there. And when we actually moved to GitHub, we decided that we actually want also to do open source if possible. So GitHub was, if you want, a good vehicle for maybe start thinking about that. So when you do something very little, something small, and you actually can open source it because it's small enough, it's nice, and it's nice tested, it's good to be in GitHub because you can create a private repository and then you can say, no, I'm gonna open it. And that's very easy if you are already there because you don't need extra work for doing that. So 2014, I think, we implemented the first project that was implemented fully continuous deployment, and this was a quite big cultural change. So speaking about Agile, this means that since 2013, we were using a continuous integration pipeline. Our software was going to be in GitHub. We used to do a commit. Automatically, our platform was taking the code, running some tests. We actually had staging environments. I don't know how many of you have seen the talk this morning about continuous delivery. I loved it. And I hate environments as well. So, but that was part of the legacy and necessary for our job. So this is one of the first things I wasn't sure about, but we did that. And we still do it. And in the real life, probably you still do these kind of things. So when we decided to do continuous deployment, so one commit to actually go to production, that was difficult, mainly because my company is a big company. We have a big legal department. We are public in the US, so we actually need to be careful with regulations, and we actually need to document everything that goes to production. We need to follow some procedures. When we actually started speaking with product and we said, we want actually our code to go to production straight away, that wasn't doable. So actually it took a lot. Even if in 2012 and 13 we already had everything in place, we still needed to push a button. And this button had to be pushed by someone that had to ask the product and had to be approved by director or a team lead, and that then was going to production. So we found out that in order to do that, we actually needed to apply some cultural change because we couldn't agree about things. And usually we used to have a deployment such as, okay, I do my code, I agree with product, I'm doing a planning that I want to release this feature or I want to fix this. We are gonna do the coding, we are gonna deploy this to the staging environment. Someone else, maybe from the same team, is gonna validate that the tests are all right, or maybe someone is gonna do even some manual QA to understand that everything is all right. And then someone from product and one from engineer are gonna say, yes, we agree, let's go to prod with this. So in order to do that, we needed to change this flow completely and reverse it. So what we changed was, okay, when we are gonna plan to release something, product and engineers are actually sitting together and they are exactly deciding what this feature is. And they are gonna set up some acceptance from the beginning, not after the code is done, but before. So if you actually define that, you say, this is gonna do this, this is gonna do this, and as soon as you release your feature, you can say, this is the test that proves that this is exactly what we agreed, this is the test that proves that this is actually what we agreed, so why you product need to have a final word? You actually don't. So what we decided was, we are gonna start working differently. First, we are gonna agree about what we want to do, then after that, that's basically the sign off. As soon as it's prioritized, it means that engineers can start working on that, and as soon as that code is ready, that's gonna go to the staging environments and straight away to prod if all the tests are green. That took like 2 years, and that's just a little thing, and the infrastructure was ready, but I think that the point of my talk today is gonna be, I'm gonna go a little bit deeper with a lot of technicalities, and I'm gonna show a lot of code, but I feel like the thing that I want you to keep in mind is, there are changes that seem easy, but take years. And that's because you need to involve a lot of people, you need to prove that things work, and you actually need time for people to understand. And sometimes it seems like something requires just a technical approach, but actually requires cultural shifts in the way people think. Yes? So, yes. So what you used to do was, okay, we want to use this feature, we are gonna put the acceptance criteria, but then before going to production, product used to say, you know what, I think that this is not enough to satisfy this acceptance, let's validate that this is like that and that. And to actually do this shift means that we actually had to rediscuss this and say, no, the acceptance needs to be locked before starting to work on something. Because as soon as you start work on something, the engineer is gonna set up the test to validate exactly what we asked for. And that's gonna go to prod without asking you anymore the permission for doing that. And we actually did that because reality is the team lead of each engineering team already knew what was happening, so it was just an useful click. Yes, I approve, of course. And the product used to basically take the time to actually understand what was happening. And obviously when we speak about all of these practices, it's worth mentioning that we don't have, since a couple of years, even like anymore a specific QA department. So QA happens in the same team. So the idea is small teams have ownership, encapsulation, responsibilities, and teams QA is on staff. We still have like a QA department, generally speaking, but I think that the role shifted more on try to validate that something is done on more something like an exploratory way to do QA. Like, let's try to find issues. And if we find issues, we actually can even create automation around that, but it's most likely to be something that tries to find issues more than actually validate things, because that's like responsibility of the team in order to validate that the acceptance are satisfied so that they can push the button. And the idea is, as soon as you do that, you don't need anymore to push a final button, because you actually have a platform that allows you to validate all the tests, and then that goes straight away to prod. So today, we have still something manual, something that is actually continuously deployed, something continuously delivered something still requires a manual push because that is actually not required. And we actually don't, we are, for different projects, we follow different policies. We are actually trying to be as more consistent as possible and try to push for continuous deployment, but some teams just don't need it, or they deploy every day and they just can push a button. But I think that the cultural shift, if you want, about the workflow with product and business, that is something that we are really trying to push for every project. So 2015, it means that last year we were complexively, for all the projects, all the teams, doing at least something around 10 deployments per day for many projects. This means that in production for mobile apps or APIs or front-end, things were changing every day, which is beautiful for a big company. A couple of days ago, I think that's worth mentioning, a new engineer comes to the office. Usually the first day of your job, when you actually join a company, you mainly spend your time on getting your machine ready, a couple of meetings with HR, defining things. But it's good that we had the opportunity to sit together at the end of the day, and we paired a little bit. He seated with someone, I think it wasn't me, it was someone else, and he was there looking, and he knows what GitHub is, he just got the permission. He found a little thing, which was, let's fix a little translation in this project. It was cool that he made a little pull request, and as soon as that PR got merged, that went straight away to production. So you can say a new hire, when I actually joined the company, my first production, so the first time my code went to production was after 3 months, I think, because I started with a new project that wasn't in production yet, I didn't know anything. Today, a new engineer can join the company, I can go to production the first day. I think that's pretty cool, because you can actually feel empowered and enthusiastic. I mean, it's very important to actually keep the enthusiasm alive, I think. So, now let's speak about the front-end project a little bit. So this may sound familiar to many people. We added a huge monolith and a huge database that used to manage everything. It was simple, if you want to understand from an architectural point of view, but it had a lot of problems. So we had stored procedures around this database to interact with data, to write and read. So DBAs used to be their own department. They used to manage the data. They used to scale the databases, to care about everything around that. Stored procedures used to be something like, okay, you need to access some data in your way. You actually submit a request to have a new stored procedures merged inside the repository of the stored procedures. Then we are going to analyze it. Maybe we are going to merge it. And then you are going to be able to have your facade to the data. Then we used to have a couple of huge .NET applications dialing directly with the stored procedures. If you want, so mainly we had this big .NET application, which was a single code base for the public website, public APIs used by mobile, public APIs used by some partners that used to integrate some of our data. And that was a single project. As you can imagine, it was a huge .NET application. It was like a solution with something like 100 sub-projects. It required, I remember when I joined, that was like the initialization phase for a new engineer. Make it run was meaning like dealing one day with actually installing all the dependencies and making all the tests green and installing everything and fixing these little hacks. It was not ideal, both for actually approaching to the code because it was a huge, very difficult to understand and to approach an application. And that wasn't very great for many reasons I'm gonna listen here. So first, we were deploying every 15 days, so that wasn't great. It means that every 15 days we had a scheduled deployment, and this means that the colleagues from San Francisco used to actually kick deployment. Everybody needed to be ready. And all the sprints for all the teams were 2-week sprints, just organized to actually coincide with the deployment. And 2 or 3 days before the deployment, we had kind of a code freeze, no merges to the main repository because we had to run all the tests that needed like 24 hours. It was crazy. And then a deployment, not very resilient. Everybody was scared actually about approaching to this project because you didn't know if that was going okay. And you were scared because it was a big, huge code base and it was complicated to approach. Not really robust, so every time we were deploying 15 days, we were deploying something that we didn't know if it was okay. As soon as it was there, if we had a problem, the only option was to immediately roll back. And when we were to roll back, we had to spend another 2 weeks, most likely, to understand what went wrong and actually trying to fix it, and then wait another 2 weeks before going live. And perhaps we were going live with that plus something else that totally needed to go to production, and it was complicated. I remember sometimes say, okay, we're gonna deploy in 15 days, oh, we need to wait another 15 days, oh, another 15 days. That was 1 month and a half for actually getting a little change maybe in production. And that was because the workflow was kind of broken. And still, we had something good. So it had consistency, so one single language. We were good on writing C#, and we used to hire good C# developers, and people were pretty good on helping each other because that was a single language. We were expert on that. We had a dedicated team for infrastructure, so every time you need provisioning, and you needed a new box, you needed to enter to a machine to see what happened. If you want, it was easy because we were consistent. We used to have Windows architecture. We had people that were very expert on that. And every time you had a problem, it was easy to find help. So if you want, engineering teams were more focused on writing code, less on taking care about infrastructure or those problems. They wrote their tests, their code. As soon as that was done, that was an ops problem. So we had a dedicated team for testing. So engineers used to write their code, and then usually it was in a 2 week sprint, something around 1 week of development, then 2 or 3 days for the QAs to actually analyze everything, and then two or three days of code freeze waiting to deploy. That wasn't great for productivity. I mean, honestly, you can make things better, but that wasn't working. We needed to do something about that. So what we did was to try the SOA route. So we decided to go to the service-oriented architecture was the new thing, and we decided to actually start splitting all the domain logic on the backend to little small services. So instead of accessing the database, we said we are gonna build little services. In our case, the business is restaurants, so let's do a locations API, a restaurant API, availability API, user API, I don't know, these little services. Each of these services could be maybe initially just to actually do the switch, just a facade for the store procedures and the old database. But then ultimately it will be services that own their data. So if you want, approaching the service-oriented architecture was, let's create first a layer of interfaces, and then these interfaces are gonna interact on the backend, initially with the old infrastructure, then they are gonna evolve in order to have more encapsulation and be more independent. And that worked, and it took a couple of years, but the result was more something like that. So we had a website that was interacting with these little services for doing their stuff. We were able to split the partners API to a new project, and this new project was working, integrating just in the APIs. So we were able to have two smaller code bases, and the mobile apps were actually able also to use these services too. So that was good for many reasons, and this talk is not really about service-oriented architecture, but I'm gonna mention just a couple of things because it's important. So obviously, we were able to release changes very often to these APIs because if we wanted to deploy availability API, and that was a very small code base and project, we didn't need anywhere to wait for 2 weeks. We were able to use good practices, software practices, design patterns. In APIs, we have versioning. We can actually, we were able to release very quick. In addition, we were able to distribute this ownership to smaller teams. So instead of having these big teams that didn't know what they were working on, and they were mainly feature teams, so working on features, they were also able to have a specific code base that they could own and they could take care of. And that translated to have smaller code bases, smaller teams that were able to have ownership, especially on the back end, because they were a very complex system that had very little product involvement, but still it was important to prove the value to product. So obviously I'm not saying that they were not dealing with product. And the teams switched. Culturally, we changed a lot. When we basically started working on this, we started creating teams that are free for people. And this is a little bit not really, it's still quite not very common, I think, because usually minimum people have teams of 6 or 7 people. But the point is, if a project was small enough And 3 or 4 people were enough to actually work on something, do some pair programming, do some QA, and work on something very small. That was very good because the team could actually be also unblocked on deploying what they wanted. They were also able to deploy in the way they wanted, and they were able to have a lot of ownership and leave freedom. That worked, and it took, again, many years to actually get to a state where this wasn't really just a mess, but was something that had logic, something that was kind of working nicely. And this means allowing people to do first just the services, then try to sit on the table and say, let's try to do monitoring all together in a new, better way, because instead of I actually do monitoring everybody how we want it, and also do logging, profiling, and integrating third party and in-house build services to actually be able to have insights about all the systems, how to deploy them, how to scale them. And that meant create an ecosystem of tools, but the consequence was creating an ecosystem of engineers that actually cared about being involved not anymore on just writing code, but actually on writing the tests, on actually making those tests green, on setting up a deployment pipeline themselves on the continuous integration pipeline, knowing exactly what was the step for making your application live, and actually having the freedom to push the buttons to make it live. So not anymore approvals by people, a totally reverted flow for actually working on new things, but also a new flow for when things were in production. That wasn't anymore something that you could forget about. Now that was something you needed to care about, and you needed to have your dashboards, you needed to know when something was going wrong because that was on your shoulders. So a lot of power with more responsibilities. And that seems something that scares a lot of people, but actually is something that engineers were so happy about because they were totally passionate about what they were doing and they were empowered on being not anymore blocked by other people for doing their job. So given this worked very well, after 2-3 years, when we tried to do something nice, something wrong, and we tried to reassess how we were doing things, we decided to approach to this problem and to try to apply the same principles to the front end. So after we created a lot of little services on the back end, we used to have still this huge .NET application, which was the legacy application, which was the consumer website. And realistically, it was complicated to work on that because mainly, I think the most cultural challenges were we were working together on the London office and the San Francisco office to this, and that was complicated because we needed to coordinate sometimes with people. And when we actually have a 8-hour of difference on the time zone, it's not easy. Usually you need in the UK to work all the day, and when it's like 5, so when you actually want to go home, San Francisco people are coming to the office. Usually if you want to have a meeting, you need to stay late, and sometimes someone from San Francisco is late, and then you end up being at home at 7, and that's like annoying. And we decided that we wanted to try to be more encapsulated. So if that worked for the services, because we had teams in London that used to have ownership for a service and teams in San Francisco that own another service that they used to deploy when they wanted, we said, how can we try to do something like that for the web? So we started working on the idea of these microsites. So what we used to call microsites, we still call them microsites. So the idea was very simple. So we had this huge legacy application and we said, let's start working on something and let's try to do a rewrite. So we had, the first thing we wanted to start was the search. So we had a new search team in the UK. It was, I think, 5 people. And they used to own the availability API and the search API on the backend. So the cool thing is that this team already had a quite deep knowledge about the domain logic of the systems. So they used to actually, on the last year or two, work a lot with this kind of problems. So they created new algorithms for actually try to display the results in a better way. They worked on features like that. But every time they wanted to bring it to the front end, it was complicated, because they actually had to depend on another team and they had to wait 2 weeks again to release this thing. So we said, let's try to do this little experiment. So the search team is gonna build a little website. We call it microsite. And that's gonna be just 1 page or 2 pages. It's probably gonna be just the search page plus the search results page, something very simple. That's gonna be a new project. Very simple, very small. It's gonna do a couple of things very well. Very simple contracts. It's gonna have a set of links, so from the home page, you're gonna go to the search page. And then we are gonna try to put a little hack on the top of the huge monolith, and we are gonna say on the routing level, if the user wants to actually go to this URL, go to the little microsite instead of the real website. And if actually, and then obviously that was just the entry point to going back to the other one. So if you actually had your result and you wanted to make a reservation or see a restaurant profile, you actually were going back to the other one. But obviously everything was hidden from the users. So everything was underneath, not using anymore the single code base and the single deployed unit, but it was actually using two things. So we tried to do that, and it was quite exciting because at the beginning it was quite easy. It was just a simple project. A little hack on the top of the routing level was able, empowered actually this team to have everything hidden from the end user. And this page looked exactly like the rest of the website, but it was a simple separated project. So this team started releasing like every 2 or 3 days where they were able to release changes into production. And the cool thing is that because the same team were owning also the backend, they were able to do things like, okay, now we are gonna experiment with this new search algorithm. We are gonna deploy the changes on the backend API, but we own the frontend too. So actually now we can deploy the changes live also to the back, to the frontend, and we can do experiments, we can do A/B testing, we can do a lot of cool stuff that other people do. And that was fantastic because it worked. So after that, we decided, okay, what if we try to do the same thing for another piece of the website? Let's try it with the home page. Maybe that can work. So as soon as we started working on the second one, we realized that it wasn't that easy. So in principle, it was very good. But as soon as we started working on the second and thinking about the third microsite, it was good because we were working on bringing something from the legacy to a new system. So with a little rewrite, we were actually able to kill a lot of old bad stuff. But we wanted a way to find a way to make this system scale. So obviously, when you have a little hack on the top, it is acceptable. And obviously, when we add search, we add a lot of duplication, like all the assets, all the logos, all the CSS. Everything was duplicated because obviously it didn't make sense to use the other resources because that would result on a dependency and they actually wanted to be independent. So they started duplicating a lot of stuff, but that was acceptable because that was the necessary condition to make them able to be totally unblocked and totally independent. But thinking about doing the second and the third and the fourth microsite, we found out, well, that's not sustainable, that doesn't scale. If you want, really realistically to do this for the entire legacy website, that would result on 10, 15 microsites. We can't afford to actually do this thing in this way. So things changed, and today, on 2015-ish, we basically were running exclusively on microsites, and all the legacy stuff was basically killed. I think we still run a couple of things there just because we don't want to re-implement it. But it's really just something we don't change anymore. So how we actually achieved this? So I'm gonna try to give you a little example of about what happens today. So today you go to opentable.com and you go to /San Francisco restaurants. So this internally converts on, this is the start microsite. So this is like the start page is what we called a page for, like the home page for that city. This means that this city needs to be rendered for the San Francisco metro location. And what happens is that we have a service that we built, which is actually something we call front door service, which organizes all the routing in a specific, in a nice way. So this translates to something like an internal instance of the start microsite, and then it's gonna convert to some kind of a translation, like specifying explicit parameters for a naturalized URL starting point. So we have something like nice SEO URLs, but they convert internally to an instance of a microsite with some specific parameters. And what happened with microsites? So today, all the microsites are very simple. We have teams of 2 to 4 developers, not more. And that works very well because the team needs to care about a very small piece of functionality. We try to aim for minimal complexity. So this means that we try to keep things small and we try to think about the domain logic of this of system. So we try to still aim for minimal dependencies and failover tolerance. So obviously, if a microsite today is working alone, we actually try to have still minimal dependencies, but actually we try to optimize reusage of code. I'm gonna explain you how. And obviously we have a lot of advantages. It's easier to test. So when we used to deploy the old application, we used to have like one day of running tests because of like 3,000 of tests that, of features that we didn't know even if we still wanted to support. Here it was easy. It is easy. All the microsites are one page or maybe two pages, and you can write your tests in a nice way. It actually is easier to maintain because the code is smaller. A new hire can approach to the code more quickly. It's easier to extend, so every time you actually have someone from product that wants to ask for something, it's easier because instead of asking someone of 50 people, can we change this thing in the homepage, you actually can go to the homepage team and can say, can we do this thing? And that's gonna be one of those two or two, four people, not 50 who know who. So it's actually easier, even from an agile perspective, to redistribute work. So obviously this results in multiple daily deployments, which means that we can make a product very happy, which means that we can make the business happy. And this works because we try to apply this service-oriented architecture, so try to make things more granular on the front-end level. But I think that the most important thing is ownership. So ownership is an important concept because ownership is something that translates to having people empowered to actually do their job on the pace. So being able to deliver when they are ready without having dependencies that are totally unuseful dependencies. Ownership means also that when you have engineers that feel empowered because they don't depend on each other, are more likely to be enthusiastic about what they do, and they can be more free to actually make ideas flow, and the release cycle becomes smaller, people are more confident, and this translates to an increase of productivity, an incredible increase of productivity and enthusiasm. So, as you can imagine, yes. That's a good question. I don't know if I have a definition myself for full stack developers, because many people today think about full stack as about a person that writes both front end and back end, or maybe someone that is like DevOps. You care about culture, you care about code, you care about testing. I think that in my idea, what I meant with this full stack engineers is that we are not anymore engineers that just write code. We are engineers that work in products that are from the back end to the front end, yes. But most importantly, we are also people that not only write code, but test code, because that's part of actually getting your job done. If you don't test your stuff, it's basically you didn't do your stuff. And this means that you have a knowledge about what happens underneath the system. You know how to find a problem as soon as it happens. You know how to do profiling of your application, and you actually have the possibility to own also the full stack kind of life of your software. So I think that's what I meant, I guess. So ownership means also that. You can't delegate anymore to ops to actually make your application live. You actually need to know when it's live, and you need to know when there is a problem, and you are the first that can fix that problem, because you can't have anymore anyone that tells you how to fix things. Now you own it, and you are the only one that knows how to do it. So I'm gonna go deeper with this a little bit later. Do you have another question? Yes. Sorry, cross? What do you mean? Yes, so the way we handle it is at the moment, so we used to have like an ops department. Use the people that used to care about deploying the application and monitoring the application. I think that when we switched to this kind of cultural model, we have seen the ops people transiting to be more something that today we call infrastructure people. But I think that the idea is they are not anymore people that fix the stuff for you. It's mainly people that go to team and help them to actually do their stuff. So as soon as the team gets the knowledge about how to use the shared systems, actually they are empowered to go along. And obviously these systems need to be maintained. For example, we have our deployment pipeline. We are investing, we have a Puppet infrastructure for provisioning that basically the ops that we call a infrastructure team now built. But this works with a pull request model. So we have a huge repository for all the code that manages the infrastructure. And when a new team starts, perhaps the new team pairs with the ops to understand how to get a new box. But as soon as they learn how to do it, then it's everything's in service. So the team needs to make a pull request to actually implement monitoring for a new system, needs to make a pull request for actually getting provisioning, and all of these systems are continuously deployed to production. So somehow the infrastructure team is the team that maintains the shared system, but also, but we actually try to invest on making the system in a way that they are kind of self-service. So the infrastructure team is more like the team that helps people to get the knowledge, I guess. So did I answer it? Yeah. So now let's speak about how we achieved the result with the microsites. So the first problem you have is the common parts. So now that we thought about a huge application, you can see microsite as slicing this little application on vertical slices. So you have teams that can deploy just this page, which is the home page, and this team is able to achieve beautiful things. For example, it can deploy without waiting for the other people. It can deploy multiple times a day. It can investigate and resolve issues quicker because instead of deploying a huge application, now we deploy a lot of smaller applications. If something is wrong with one, you actually can focus on that one. You don't have any more to think about something huge and that you don't know how to approach. When we want to scale our application in our infrastructure, we can scale better because we can scale just the applications that we need more traffic. We can actually scale down things that are require less traffic, etc. So it's actually also a better way to manage the infrastructure. So how to solve the common parts? So as engineers, we care about quality, and one of the problems we have here is, okay, I want to be independent, so I'm gonna accept some trade-offs. And at the beginning, we saw, okay, the first microsite said, okay, we are gonna duplicate everything, and we don't care how to make it scale. So we had to think about how to connect all these vertical slices in a horizontal way. So we wanted to have more code reusage. And we wanted actually to have a better way to handle common parts. So specifically on the front end, a little example could be on the old monolith, I wanted to change a little link on the footer. I actually needed to find someone to do it, and then that was going to the master branch, and then I needed to wait 2 weeks, and that was live everywhere on the website because the footer was a shared component inside a single project. So how to change a link today that we have 15 microsites. So we decided to think about how to componentize pages on a new level, on a smaller level, so how to share the common parts for the web. And we actually build a service to actually serve the common parts. So again, let me try to give you an example. So if today I go to search and I try to make a search for San Francisco for a specific daytime, this goes to the search microsite. So internally, we have something that resolves on something like that. That's an instance of that application. So what this does is it executes logic. For example, if you are search page, you go to search service, you try to get availability, you get some data that you need. Then you go to components API to actually get the shared components, for example, the header and the footer, etc. And then you render a page that looks like something like that. So if you want, we created a service that you needed to, as a page, to consume every time on runtime a request was coming to you, to to actually get the source of truth. So which means that every time we wanted to make a change in the footer, we were able to actually make a change in just the footer component. And at that point, everybody in production was getting this change because we were deploying the footer. So how does it work? So today we work in this way. We try to approach many ways to this problem. And we consolidated to this, which is a kind of a combination of a simple API to serve components, which was something we had at the beginning, to something a little bit more dynamic, which I'm going to describe on the second part of this talk. So when you actually try to get a component, for example, the header of the consumer website, we have something similar. So we have an internal instance of the header. It goes to a service that shares all the components. You ask for the header. And then we implemented a couple of things. So first, we implemented semantic versioning, which means that we were able to roll out a lot of changes here because we have the possibility to have simple contracts to describe what was happening. So when you actually make changes on the header or pieces that have client-side JavaScript, the last thing you want is to have a system like that that at some point breaks everything. So if you have a system like to share the header and you put some JavaScript and that JavaScript is broken, if you actually make it live, all the microsites are going to be broken. So how to do that? It's complicated from an integration point of view to run tests and ensure that everybody that integrates the component is actually going to be okay. I mean, it's simple maybe for some simple components that perhaps have simple markup, but it can be quite challenging for components that start to have CSS, shared client-side JavaScript, and things like that. So when we try to approach this problem, we thought about a couple of ideas. So the API was just one of them. We thought about server-side includes. We thought about CDN, integrate with the CDN for actually getting these contexts, shared contexts in a static way. But we found out that it didn't work because the main point of the SOA was let's have simple contracts to actually define interfaces. Now you have specific service that do something very small, something very well, something simple to understand and to integrate. Having server-side includes or mechanism like that was actually against the general philosophy, and people didn't like it. So we tried to investigate something like that, so something like a layer on top of the microsite that could automatically render all the shared parts. But that was crazy, because at some point, the microsite was seeing something wrong, and they didn't know how to fix it, because they didn't have control. So the microsite wanted to have control. And with semantic versioning, we achieved that. We say, you want the header, but you want version one. Version one is going to have a kind of a specific interface, specific parameters, some specific conventions, and you know that we are not going to break it. As soon as we apply a new breaking change, because we are going to switch to a new library for a front-end client-side dependency, we are going to push V2. And if you consume V1 of the header, like the latest minor and patch version of the header, you know that you are safe. And you know what? If you consume a component that is owned by a team that you don't trust, you can consume version 1.2.3. And that's never going to break. And every time you release your microsite, you can upgrade your dependency for the shared components, and you are totally safe. So the idea is still having something shared, but something that could empower the microsite owners to still have control and ownership across what was going to the page. As I mentioned, we decided to implement something like an API, very clear for the components, so that they could handle logic. So the cool thing about this is that, if you want, it's a little bit unusual. When you see systems like that nowadays, especially with the kind of gold era of new JavaScript frameworks, it's quite common to see a quite clear a separation between what is in the front end and what is in the back end. So systems like that usually don't handle logic. So you get just the assets, and then that's pretty much something like a clear, a simple template that then gets replaced with translations if you implement the same thing in many languages, logic if you actually, for example, in the case of the header, you want to handle the same component for the logged in header or the logged out header, so you need to show the sign up or the sign out button instead. And the cool thing is that with a system like that, instead, we actually try to challenge this. So we said if components are something like little partials that can handle logic themselves, it's easier for the micro site to integrate, because components like that could have a logic like, give me the metro ID, which is the identifier for the location, and the component could do itself a request to location API to get some data and to share you the beautiful city name on the top, you are here. So it was good because we were able to have a new level of encapsulation and in a way to make two teams work together. One team wanted to handle the header, one team wanted to handle the microsite. Now the header maintainer were able to share a simple interface, that's the contract. The microsite were able to see the contract, integration was easier. Other things like conventions, we decided to use accept language for all the translations so that the header could come exactly on that language, ready for you, simple. The output was basically something like that. A little piece of HTML that the microsite could just take and put in the page. So the contract was very easy. Give me the header, give me the American header for in American English, for this specific location, for this user type, and then that gets HTML. This HTML gets resources links, for example, a logo in case of the header, and that logo is responsibility for the component to host this logo somewhere, so that the microsite could have a very simple way to integrate things, but also we were able to remove the duplication. So one problem we had with the first problem of people duplicating resources was not only that it was bad for engineering in general for your code, was that people were actually going to a website that looked like just a giant website, going to page by page, but the logo was downloaded every time because that was duplicated in each site. So that was also not really performant for client side point of view. In this way, having a single source of truth, we could have the same URL for the logo in the same place. So the markup could be exactly the same and the problem could be solved. And we did that and it worked. So what we achieved with this combination of the two? So we had consistency. So the first, instead of actually having something that we didn't know when was going live because it was something like 15 applications, now with this simple contract, we were able to say, we are gonna make a change in the footer, we are gonna release the footer. The footer is gonna be live on all the microsites, and that's gonna be live in exactly the same moment. So consistency. Coordination. So coordination basically wasn't required. So we didn't need to ask 15 people to release a new thing, because instead of having a library that shared the assets, which is usually what you have with a clear front-end and back-end separation, we actually had something like a runtime system. So we didn't need to ask the footer team to ask 15 people to redeploy their application, and these 15 people didn't know when we were releasing things in the future. So basically these two teams, even if they were geolocating in two different parts of the world, were totally able to do their job independently. Optimal front-end loading, because as I said, we didn't have duplication of resources anymore, so the user navigating to page by page was actually navigating to something that, from a point of view of the resources, was exactly the same website. And it was easy to spin up new microsites, so we realized that having a system like that was easy to say, we are gonna move this thing away, we are gonna create this new idea for the business, and we integrate the shared components. You have something like a skeleton page that already has all the layout. Now the team can focus just on the domain logic about this new thing. So you don't need to care about the front end because we built components for the header, the footer, things like the adverts, but also something like for the shared CSS, for the shared CSS of the website. So we had like a project with the CSS, the style guide, all the styling, a project for the shared core JavaScript libraries. So basically, if you wanted to create something new, everything was ready to go. And that worked very well also for retiring the old monolith. Because in 1 year and so, we built first the first critical part, and then at the end, we actually were able to run a new infrastructure that was a lot of little applications, but handled by a lot of little teams, and teams were able to go very quickly. So the last thing I wanted to mention is what happens on the cultural point of view. So on the product point of view. So what happened 2 or 3 years ago when we had this huge monolithic application? It used to happen something like, okay, the business realized that we want to change this thing. And Now we are gonna try to speak with someone on engineering. We are gonna try to set up some meetings to ask who is the people that are gonna do that. Maybe this team is gonna do it, maybe this other team. Then that gets prioritized, and then the teams needs to do the coding, and then the testing, and then they need to wait for actually deploying that, and then the business gets a notice that says, well, this is in production now, thanks. And that was like 2 months later. So that was crazy because of the whole the interactions, all the steps, and all the unuseful steps that actually we need to follow before going to production. So the cool thing is that if you think about what happens here, I think, on when you make a little search, I think that the cool thing is that we actually make our code to look more like our business. So as I mentioned at the beginning, you are a user, you digit the URL, you have a service that tells you that this is start microsite, then he finds out the information for you, then it translates to a specific URL, and then start microsite does his own thing. So the cool thing is that if you think about culturally, it's pretty much the same now. So the product needs to make a change on the website, and usually what happens is that someone says, what is this change? Is this on the home page? Is it on the search? Where is it? Is on start? Okay, so that's the start team. So I'm gonna go speaking directly with that team. I already skipped like a lot of unuseful meetings to understand who is gonna do that and who is gonna prioritize it. Because from the product point of view, the business now knows exactly who asked for doing something. And that's not anymore something like a team of 10 people, it's a team of 2 people. And these people are gonna have less stuff to do, and they are gonna be working on a very small code base that they can release it when they want. So these people are gonna be able to do what they want, and they are gonna be able to deal directly with business and product as soon as that's gonna be done. So culturally, we build this as a projection of actually the cultural need that we had. And I think that worked very well, because today our code looks more like the business and our product needs. And this may sound very complicated, but you need to understand also that one very key element of our complexity was making it work like in a very optimal way, people geolocated in many different places. So sometimes you say, we need to be coordinated to deploy something, and we are, I don't know, 10 teams, but we are sitting on the same room and there are like 10 tables, and we need to say, well, tomorrow we need to release this all together because there is like this critical thing and we need to be coordinated. Maybe that's not a problem, really, because we are in the same room. You can say, let's do this together, and you're gonna do it. But the problem is that, and then so think about when 2 teams work together on the same code base, you say, can you review this thing? Yes. Can you change this thing because I don't like it? Yes. And they can sit together, they can do it. What happens when you have people working on UK and US? You have people that says, can we do a meeting to actually discuss this? Yes, that's gonna be 3-4 days before doing a point on the calendar that is good for both. And then, okay, we are gonna do a pull request to this repository. And then that goes there, and then maybe the team that needs to review it is busy that day, and the other guy goes to the office back and says, do I have an email from him? Oh no, okay, I need to wait from tomorrow. I'm gonna send another email and say, can you review it today because I'm blocked by you. And the other guy says, oh yeah, I apologize, sorry, I forgot. Can you change these things? And then he goes back and does these things, and that's gonna take 2 weeks. So I think that part of us actually making all of these choices from an architectural point of view was also to try to solve this cultural problem of working on multiple time zones. And I think that what we try to do is, if we have an infrastructure that maybe is topologically a little bit more complicated because you have like a lot of little points that communicate all together, but they communicate together with very simple and clear interfaces, well, maybe that's actually the key. Because when a team like this used to own the other, and a microsite used to be in the US, they could go to a page with a documentation, they could consume the other without waking up the other team. And if they had an issue or maybe a feature request, they could do it, but... So I think that the first part of this talk is this one. How is the timer? Okay, first hour, oh, that's cool. I need to be quicker. And so basically, the idea for being more agile on the first part was simple contracts, simple interfaces, at the cost of actually something a little bit more complicated. But the main point was you need to understand that code implies a lot of cultural shifts. So in my experience, we did a lot of changes on the code, but that implied a lot of change on the culture. And today we actually are working better because we made the code look like what it needed to be for our culture. And then we found out that we needed something different because the culture evolved as well and the code evolved as well. So on the second part, I'm gonna show you how this thing evolved even more, because this is like the representation of like 1 year and a half ago. So we made other stuff and I'm gonna show you it on the second part. So while we wait for the screen, are there any questions now? Maybe we can spend a couple of minutes on that, if you have. No? Yes? Yeah. The 10 times a day was like an estimate for like 1 year ago. I think I would say that today we have been even more than that. When I said releases, I mean actually releases of one of the systems that somehow have a consequence on what you see in production, which means that maybe 10 teams are releasing once a day. It's not the same team that is releasing 10 times. But sometimes we have also the same team that releases 10 to 20 times because they have 20 little fixes or features that actually go live straight away. In regards of the feature toggle, yes. So we use them a lot. We actually created, I'm gonna show the link at the end maybe. We actually open sourced a little framework for doing that, which is called OpenOp. And it's basically a system that allows access to engineers and product to a set of feature toggles. So an engineer wants to release something, when he creates a new toggle, he can create it with a little UI, a web interface. And both the product and engineers for their team have ownership of actually flipping the toggle, both on the staging environment and on the production environment. I mean, obviously, it's a system that in theory should aim for not having a QA environment and a staging environment, but in theory, but in practice, we have it anyway. And the cool thing about that is that you can say, okay, the team is ready to go live with 10 things, but product wants to release them once a week. That's fine, because the team is gonna be done. And then that's gonna go to the product person's shoulders, and he's gonna have authority to actually flip things on and off. And usually what happens is that we have two types of features usually. One is a feature that you want to make live, but you still don't know if you want it. So usually that's more something that we associate to the A/B testing kind of thing. We have actually an A/B testing framework as well for actually integrating the two systems together. And usually what happens is you create a feature, you actually put a toggle in an A/B test in it, so you have metrics. After a period, you decide if you want to keep it or not. And when you do that, then you can release, you can basically put the full feature off, you can do rework on the code to do the cleanup, and you can just release it as soon as you're ready. The second thing instead is when you actually want to release something and you know that you definitely want it, but you actually can't because you have dependencies. So for example, you want to release a new design of the website. We did that, and we worked on that a couple of months. So we used to have a feature toggle to actually use the old design, and the feature toggle was on just in the staging so that we could wait everybody to do the changes. And at some point, when we were ready, we actually toggled one thing in prod and champagne. We released a new website, but that was actually not deployment. It was just toggling a little feature. And that was cool because that happened when I was sleeping because our headquarters are in San Francisco and I'm based in London. And so I didn't need to stay up all night for that, which is cool. So other questions? Yes?
Yeah. So who takes this decision?
So I think at the beginning it was really just a combination of trying to do the same thing we did on the back end, because on the back end we already were coming from 1 year or two of our service-oriented architecture. So we reorganized anyway the back end in order to connect the database to the mobile apps and to other things in a better way. and we actually understood how to do a lot of things well. So we said, now we get the knowledge to actually try to do this thing on the front end. And I think that at the beginning it was just really just an experiment. And the motivations were two. One, to get away from the monolith. And if you want, the microsite was a way to actually rebuild partially, but keeping alive the old monster on the site. And that was good because you could do it progressively. And the second thing was to test the idea of actually having something that could someday be totally powered by microsites. And actually that revealed to be good and successful, both for the productivity and both for the culture, because it's easier today to organize things in this way. I mean, it works very well for us. I don't think is very good for everybody. But I don't think in this talk I'm trying to aim for telling anyone to do what we did. I think is the main purpose of this talk is most likely to tell our story and to maybe inspire you to maybe do something like that. How many of you, for example, work with colleagues that are geolocated in different places? Yeah. So do you think, so you probably recognize a little bit the coordination problem, right? And I mean, it's not really to criticize people. I'm not saying that the UK office was better than the US or the one. It's just that sometimes you need to rework the way you communicate and work, because there are realistically limits on not being in the same office. And you want to actually improve these people's workflow. And I think it's totally possible. Personally, I actually feel like the future for engineering is actually remote working all the way through. And I believe that's the future. But I feel like that before going to there, we actually need companies and people to understand that we need to rework to work in a better way. So we need to go online first. We need to apply a lot of cultural shifts. And perhaps it needs that sometimes your software evolves in such ways that you decompose things in order to be more empowered and more independent. And I think that works. So other questions? OK. So now I'm going to go to the next stage. Sorry? 22? 30 minutes. OK. I'm going to try. So in the next part, I'm going to speak about Open Components, which is like a framework, another framework we open sourced. And this is mainly what we found out when we were working on the microsite. So again, we had now, 1 year and a half ago, we had a couple of teams doing handling, basically owning one or two microsites. We had one team, which happened to be my team, that used to actually own the shared components API. Which used to have the header, the footer, the advert, shared components. And we found out that this was going very well, but at some point the shared components team, which was my team, was going to be a little bit saturated. So the problems were mainly people got excited about this. So at some point we went receiving people requests and saying, okay, I have this, I developed this shared component, but I think this is needed by other two or three microsites. So we were trying to evangelizing the principle that if you need to do something on the front end that is like a widget that needs to be shared, you should create a component for that. But the team that was actually handling these components API was receiving so many pull requests, and the components were growing so much. So we wanted to find a better way to scale this componentized system. And also we wanted to introduce new things, something like semantic version, which is something we were not doing very well on the old system, and improve things. So we built this framework, and this is pretty much like how it works. I'm going to show you the basics. So we basically created a self-service service to create components as a service. So we created something that is called the Open Components Registry, which is basically similar to the old API to serve the components. And this could actually be used to consume components, so actually to retrieve these components, but also for components creator to create components and to publish them. So this system became something like an interface, which is a REST interface, which was running all the time. And then we created something like an Open Component CLI, which was an utility that people could use to create, to test, and to publish components. And obviously, as soon as that was created and published, they could publish new versions, and they could keep maintaining that. And the way it works is that as soon as a component is published, The registry finds out what it is, may analyze it, tries to decompose the code and make some testing and sees everything is ready. And then it publishes to the CDN. So for example, if this component contains images or CSS, shared static resources, an automatic pipeline is gonna publish this to something that is gonna be production ready, connecting the CDN and everything. And in a couple of seconds, these people are gonna have a URL, which is the component's URL, that is ready to be consumed in production. And obviously, then we have something like the runtime agents that are the things that consume the server-side part of the component. So I'm gonna try to do a little demo now. And I'm gonna try not really to go really deeper into this framework, because I think that's not really the purpose of this presentation. But I think like I want to show you how we actually try to make easy to make changes in such a way that the business could have something really useful very soon. So how many of you are, I've seen a lot of engineers, so how many of you are familiar with Node.js? A couple, yeah. Okay, so this is basically, the framework itself is in Node, but the cool thing is that as soon as you have an endpoint that actually has a component with a clear interface, you can consume it from anywhere. For example, we have a couple of microsites written in .NET, we have one in Ruby, we have other in Node, but they use the same API and they can consume components independent on the technology. So now I'm gonna show you why it works. So let me try to zoom. Can you see this? Yes. I'm gonna try to do a little bit of like live coding. So OC is open source, then you can install it when you actually just doing npm install goc. And I'm not gonna do this, because the network is, I don't know. And after you do that, you actually have a little CLI. So do something like CLI, let's create a components folder, make dear Agile India, and CD Agile India. I have a blank folder, I do UC init my component. I will call it Agile India. And how many of you are familiar with Jade, right, view engine? Couple, okay. We support both Jade and Handlebars. I'm gonna use Jade because someone knows, but it's gonna be very simple to understand. So I created a small components, and that's basically a folder. I'm gonna show you how it looks. It's gonna be very simple, I promise. This is my components folder, and this is my component. My component contains a view, contains a little server-side part, and contains a description of the package. It's very simple. Basically, what we have here, if you think about an MVC architecture on the web, is basically a system to provide partials. And you can include them on the websites, like they will be iframes, but they are not iframes, so that you can integrate them easily and do crazy stuff with them. I'm gonna show you in 5 minutes, promise. So we created a new component, and I'm gonna say this is a test component. This is version one. I can include a repository, and I'm gonna save this. So next thing I want to do is I want to set up a test environment, and I can do a cdev listening to this folder. This is gonna basically start a test registry in my computer that is gonna be able enable me to test this component. So this is an example of my registry. And I'm gonna go to my component. I'm gonna have an auto-generated documentation. My component does nothing for now because it's a new component. So I'm gonna go here. I'm gonna open a new one. I'm gonna keep running my registry and I'm gonna start making changes. So I'm gonna go to my editor and I'm gonna say, okay, div, hello, my name is Matteo, and I'm gonna create, so this is Jade for saying like a div with a, my name is, it's very simple. And now I want to create a little server-side part, which is gonna say something like, I'm just gonna call back a view model, which is gonna use by my view to render the HTML, to be transformed to a view, to an HTML. Name is basically something like context, params name, and if not, is OpenTable. So if I do this, I can go to my page, I can refresh, and I can see, hello, my name is Matteo. And the component, to include this component on the client side, I need basically just something like this. So this is an OC component tag with an href, and I can do this. If I do something like name equal Jack, this is gonna be, hello, my name is Jack. So we have clear parameters, and another thing I can do here is actually to make these things explicit. So optionally, I can go here, and I can say something like parameters. I can say name. I can say type is a string. I'm gonna say that is not mandatory, so it's an optional parameter. I'm gonna provide an example, something like Jack, and I'm gonna say what it is, your name. If I save this and now I go to the web interface and I refresh this page, I can see that I have like an automatically generated documentation. So I worked a very simple component, and I can have static resources here. The framework automatically does a lot of magic for you. But the point is, I found out that now I have my component. And if I totally want to test this, and I'm gonna show you how it works. This is the web interface, but I can go to my registry, and I can make actually a request to Agile India. So here you have something that contains your HTML, contains some data, and is ready to be integrated. When I actually want to put it in a page, I do something simple like that. New page source. Oh, this is server-side rendered. Let me go to the other one. I'm gonna show you it later. So if I do OC preview HTTP localhost Agile India, I can see my component and how it looks like. So now that I'm happy, I want to publish this, and I actually do something very simple. I connect a registry to my folder, so I see something like OC registry add, and here I created a registry for this presentation. We have one at OpenTable. Here, basically, connection, if the connection works, this is gonna go to the registry, it's gonna find out that the registry is valid, and then it's gonna connect it. It says that it's not valid, maybe my connection is off. Yes, it is. Let's retry. Yes, now the connection worked. So now I can say something like, OC, publish Agile India. Oh, what I am? Oh, I moved to another folder, sure. Okay, let's go to the right one, sorry. Okay, this should be the right one, where my components are. See, publish Agile India, which is my component. And, I need a bit more recent version, let's try. Hopefully my connection is gonna work. So this is just me being bad on preparing demos. I apologize, I should get more prepared. So the cool thing is, as soon as I do this, I go something, I create a component, and obviously I'm a good developer, so I create some tests, I actually ensure that everything works, and then I have the possibility to publish this in production. And this takes like 2 seconds. So the cool thing about this is that I have an app something that allows me to use a shared interface, which is the OC registry. Let's retry now. And allows me to create something new. And that's production ready for the business. So if I go to this URL now, and I do OC preview this, which is in the public internet, this is gonna work. And that's it. So the cool thing is that we have, We have things like I can consume the latest version of a component. So I want just the latest patch and minor, so I can do this. And if I want to consume this component, I can go to the registry. This is now updated, so it should contain my component too. Let's refresh. Here it is. So I can share this link with other engineers, and I can say, if you want to consume this component, this is the API, this is simple, and that's done. So let me share. The rest of the slides are going to be just a couple, just to explain you why we did this. So we did this, we ship it. You can have static resources like images, CSS. The framework actually bundles everything for you that is ready. And the cool thing is that you can integrate it on the client side in a such way that is very simple like that. This script here is like a library of 5 kilobytes, so it's very small and supports all the browsers like IE8. And I can actually, if I create a component and I want to integrate it in a microsite, or I want to create an A/B test to put it everywhere on the website, I can ask someone to integrate two lines of code. So if you actually want to share a new component, which is an experiment, is actually something new, is a widget, I can ask people to make a PR for two lines of code. So how complicated is going to be for someone to review this pull request if I actually need to wait for another one that is located in another continent to review this? They need to agree that they are consuming the right version with the right parameters, and that's it. If you actually want to consume things on the server side, you can actually make a request on the server side using the API. So that's the previous one makes a client-side rendering as soon as the page is loaded. And the cool thing is that these components are totally isomorphic, so you can consume them on the server side as well, and you can get the HTML. So if you actually want something that is important for SEO, you can actually do it on the server side. And there are also crazy things like if you use Node or client side, it actually is quite optimal. Like it gets the data first and the model, it caches stuff. It does a lot of magic for you, so it's actually pretty performant. And it's been in production for like 1 year now, the OpenTable. Since it's release in production, we had something like 52 components. On the old system, we had 9 components, which was header, footer, advert, something like that. In 1 year, people used it for doing a lot of stuff, like creating new tests, and they didn't need to ask anyone to do anything because they had a new system that empowered them to create something and to put it live with a simple contract. So what the features are, enabling people to create and publish new components independently, which is important because it empowers people to actually do experimentation and to do stuff well. Granular ownership, because we have simple contracts and people can do integrations in a very simple way. We have performances, because the framework has a lot of things. And also, you can use isomorphism as a failover strategy, because if on the server side you want to render a component which is big but is taking too much, or maybe the registry is not responding because you don't want this dependency, you can use client-side rendering as a failover. So you can actually return when you try to publish this, to render this. If this doesn't respond, you actually put this on the client side, and that's going to render on the client side as a failover. So if you want a bad thing about the old system was that we had a new hard dependency for all the microsites. If the system of the components were down or slow, all the microsites were down. Here we have actually a new failover strategy, which is agreed and works very well. Yeah. So the OC tag is rendered by a little client. So when you actually integrate this, you have like a little piece of JavaScript here. And this actually automatically goes. There is also a little API on the client to do more complicated stuff, like render it on the go, or having a set of events to actually listen to what is rendered or not. And you can do stuff like testing components. You can do everything. So this is just a very simple things. And the cool thing is that it serves as framework for experimenting with A/B testing. So A/B testing, we used to do it a lot. 2-3 years ago, we started using third-party options. And what we used to have is like third-party things that allow you to inject any piece of code in your pages. And usually what you have is people that break stuff, and they know that that's an experiment of someone. So you disable the experiment and say, oh, that's some crappy code that someone put there and we don't know what it is. With this system, actually, people were able to create a new thing, put some tests on it, and then the A/B test could be just put this component here or put this component here, and you could have a feature toggle on top of a component that could say, put this component here or don't put this component here. So actually, this integrated very well with the existing infrastructure of the feature toggle and everything. And now we could integrate the components to our continuous integration pipeline and put some tests and actually made them completely able to be delivered to production immediately automatically. So obviously when I showed you earlier OC publish, it's good for a demonstration, but in our real use case, this actually goes to a Git commit, pull requests get merged, automatically this goes to the continuing integration and you do nothing. And this takes, if you have a decent amount of tests, basically to go to production, the time of executing the test, plus 1 second. So this is actually pretty cool because it usually empowers teams to, I've seen teams releasing components like 20 times in a day. Because actually you don't have anything that blocks you. And if you use semantic versioning, everything is freezed. So everything is immutable. So you actually need to create a new version every time. And with the interface, you can navigate previous versions. And microservices have a control. So I'm gonna go to the last piece of my talk, which is the conclusions. I don't know how much time I have. 1 minute, oh shit, sorry. So what is a microservice? Good question. I'm gonna try to answer this question. I feel like when I heard the word microservice for the first time, I say, what is a microservice? That's just a new word, but it's just a service. Like you want to do a well-designed service, you have encapsulation, you have control, good testing. That's just a good characteristic of a service. Microservice is just a word. Then I've seen myself changing my mind. I feel like the secret of microservices is a little bit understanding that something is doing something nice for a technology point of view. Something is actually applying the cultural shifts that that needs. Microservice for me is like telling today that we actually are doing this after 5 years of failures and successes. And today, something like that is something very macro. So I've seen this talk. I would recommend it to watch it. It's beautiful. And it basically approaches to the idea of what is that we do for doing very good software. We actually try to do highly maintainable software. What about making the software small enough that is actually highly destroyable so that you can actually rebuild it every time you need because it's so small that actually, and you have the infrastructure that allows you to do something new very easily without actually blockers. So perhaps the secret is a microservice is something that you can easily destroy and you don't care because you can just rebuild it and that requires no effort from an infrastructure point of view or cultural point of view. Other couple of recommendations, I will say let's stay always close to the business. The reasons why we did this is to be more agile. This book is something I love. It's called Start With Why and it allows you to approach to the why are you doing things? Are you really needing this complexity? I'm gonna go very quickly. This is another book I will recommend about ownership. I'm gonna share my slides later on Twitter. So I don't know if I have the time for my conclusions, but I will say this is the secret for me for microservices. Minimal dependencies, minimal complexity, stay close to the business, and trust people. Hire good people, empower them, and trust them. That's the secret for being agile. And yeah, test. Failure is a feature. Think about failure when you actually do something and componentize everything. Thank you. That was it. Questions? No time for it, I guess. Yeah, thank you. follow me on Twitter. I'm gonna share my slides and everything later. And I'm gonna be around to speak about this more given the time is over. Thank you for attending.